Greetings to all Africans all over the world. Sanu, Jambu, No. Greetings to all our ancestors because of whom we are. I greet all African heads of states, all African heads of organizations, all African persons and non-African persons working 24 hours every single day for the good of the continent and the people of Africa. And I say, well done to you all. I salute all OAF leaders and members all over the world. The leaders and people of Africa can trust you because you have the willingness, the character, and the capacity to transform the African continent to her glory. I come in the name of the Most High God, who has called us into this glorious task of leading Africa into her destiny. On this day, I shall be talking on the issue of reparations for the transatlantic slave trade. And reparations, as we know it, has to do with to repair a damage. It has to do with restitution, with restoration of what was lost. And during the slave trade, Africa lost a lot, which we're going to see. The slave trade has to do with a trade on human beings, where human beings were sold as goods. Transatlantic, in that trans has to do with movement across, or movement from one place to the other. And Atlantic, so it has to do with trade across the Atlantic Ocean, because the trade we're talking about was carried out across the Atlantic Ocean. Africa, Europe, and the Americas are demarcated by the Atlantic Ocean, and the slave trade was across the Atlantic Ocean. So this topic is reparations for the transatlantic slave trade. Now let's talk about how this slave trade began. First of all, the slave trade began in the year 1441, and the Portuguese began the slave trade. Two Portuguese slave traders by the name Anto Gonçalves and Nuno Tristo were the first two Portuguese to start the slave trade, and they were captains. They came into the west coast of Africa at Cape Branco in Mauritania, took 12 Africans, sold them as slaves in Lisbon, Portugal. In the year 1444, another Portuguese captain by the name Lanzarote de Freitas came into the west coast of Africa again at the Bay of Arguin in the same Mauritania, took 235 Africans forcefully and sold them as slaves in his hometown of Lagos in Portugal. So began the slave trade. The slave raids and trade continued. Eventually, the Portuguese began to set up slave forts across the west coast of Africa and began to build slave plantations where they were forcing Africans to labor for them freely, and to also build slave plantations in Portugal. Eventually, Portuguese slave traders began to have their ports in Seville in Spain and to recruit Spanish traders into this trade. And eventually, from the 1470s, the Spaniards began to make entry into the transatlantic slave trade. And eventually, the slave trade began to escalate little by little until the year 1492. On the 12th of October, 1492, Christopher Columbus became the first European confirmed to have stepped his foot on the Americas. And this European landing on the Americas changed the whole story. It worsened the transatlantic slave trade, just like dusk is followed immediately by night. From the year 1492, after the discovery of the Americas, Europeans began to troop into the Americas and to take over last swaths of continental lands to themselves. Eventually, Europeans saw these lands as lands that could be cultivated to make large profits, and they immediately tried to put the indigenous Americans to work on those lands, but it couldn't work. Eventually, they saw that Africans were the best option. Why? One, they saw that Africans were relatively strong. Two, they saw that Africans were relatively immune to diseases that were killing the indigenous Americans. For example, smallpox. Also, they saw that Africans knew some agricultural techniques which were going to be useful to them. And they also saw that Africans were already theirs for the taking, that Africans were going to give them free labor. Therefore, they chose the continent of Africa as their choice of source for slaves and people of Africa for the slaves. And that's how Europeans began to bring in Africans into the Americas for the slave trade, for them to work on those plantations. So eventually, the year 1501, the Spaniards brought in the first wave of enslaved Africans to the Americas in Hispaniola, present-day the Dominican Republic and Haiti. From the year 1545, the Portuguese began to bring in their own first wave of enslaved Africans into the Americas. From the year 1562, John Hawkins, an Englishman, became the first Englishman to make entry into the transatlantic slave trade, going into modern-day Sierra Leone three times to bring in enslaved Africans to the Americas. And he was also known to be the father of the triangular slave trade, which would make stops at different the Americas, Europe, and Africa, making profits at each stop. So eventually, the French, the Danish, and all these people made their entry into the transatlantic slave trade. And eventually, after it was all said and done, over 10 million Africans would be sold as slaves in the Americas. And over 3.5 million Africans are still buried at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean till today. And tens of millions of Africans would die in slave wars fought to produce slaves. And this slave trade would cost the continent of Africa over 2 billion people indirectly in population. Let's talk about the effects of this slave trade. Let's talk about the triangular effects of the slave trade. Bear in mind, like I said earlier, that three main regions were involved in the transatlantic slave trade, namely Europe, Africa, and the Americas. And let's talk about the effect of the slave trade on Europe. The European continent profited highly from the slave trade. European families, businesses, organizations profited heavily from the slave trade. For example, the cities of Birmingham, Manchester, all the cities, Glasgow in the UK, flourished because of the slave trade. The city of Manchester in UK profited from the sale of cotton, which was imported from the Americas. The city of Birmingham made a lot of profits exchanging guns for slaves. Cities of Glasgow in Britain, Great Britain, and other cities, they made a lot of money from the slave trade. Also, the Barclay brothers funded Barclay banks from proceeds from the transatlantic slave trade. Also, in Europe, the Industrial Revolution began in Europe, and it was funded by the proceeds from the transatlantic slave trade. In fact, according to BBC, it was in cotton that the Industrial Revolution began, and especially in and around Manchester in UK. And it was because of cotton that was flooding in to Manchester from the slave plantations that the Industrial Revolution began, mostly in Manchester. Also, the funding of the steam engine, which was built by James Watt, was funded through proceeds from the transatlantic slave trade. So without the transatlantic slave trade, probably there couldn't have been the Industrial Revolution. So that was the effect of the transatlantic slave trade on Europe. It had an enriching effect on Europe. It blessed the Europeans and made them very wealthy. Until today, much of the wealth of Europe is still traceable to the transatlantic slave trade. And the Industrial Revolution I will talk about was the event that wiped out poverty in Europe and was able to cancel out the prophecy of Malthus that there was going to be death, catastrophe in Europe because of the population of Europe was growing at a geometric progression while food production was growing at an arithmetic progression. It was the Industrial Revolution that averted that prophecy. Therefore, the transatlantic slave trade saved Europe and built Europe. Also, let's talk about the effects of the transatlantic slave trade on the Americas. The transatlantic slave trade built the Americas east, north, west, south, central, all around. Without the transatlantic slave trade, America or the US wouldn't have been as wealthy as it is today. It was the slave labor of Africans that built the Brazil, built the Americas, built US and all those countries in the Western Hemisphere of the world. Africans worked in slave plantations producing cotton, sugar cane. They worked as masons, domestic servants. They worked to build the American economy. Without the African labor, America as a continent or as a string of continents would have been as wealthy as it is today. Now let's talk about the effects of the transatlantic slave trade on Africa. The transatlantic slave trade destroyed the African society. Let's talk about the effects of the transatlantic slave trade on the population of Africa. By the year 1700, the population of Africa fell by 1 million to about 106 million. By the year 1800, the population of Africa was only about 107 million. But following the abolition of slavery and slave trade in the 19th centuries, by the year 1850, the population of Africa rose from about 111 million to about 767 million by the year 1900, and over 1.3 billion as I speak. These figures prove that the transatlantic slave trade cost the African population over 2 billion persons. Let's talk about the effects of this trade on peace and conflict in Africa. The transatlantic slave trade caused conflicts all over Africa, as kingdoms fought against kingdom in order to produce slaves rather than to build an economy, which also leads to the third effect, poverty in Africa. Instead of producing products in Africa, Africans were producing slaves. Europeans mentioned that Africans were producing slaves in Africa. And because of that, the African economy went down, just like the population. But unfortunately, the population of Africa rose following the abolition of the slave trade and slavery, but the economy of Africa could not rebound as much or as fast, because even after the slave trade, there was colonization, and even to today, new colonialism. Also, we can talk about the effects of the transatlantic slave trade on racism. The transatlantic slave trade gave rise to the notion that the people of Africa were born to be slaves, because the transatlantic slave trade was the only slave trade that focused on one particular people group and continent, the continent and people of Africa. Unlike the Arab slave trade, which don't focus on only the Africans or whites, it cut across people groups. That of the Mongolians during the time of Genghis Khan and his successors did not focus on a particular people group. That of the Roman slave trade era did not also focus on any particular people group. But that of the transatlantic slave trade focused on the people of Africa. Therefore, people believed that Africans were born to be slaves, that Africans had always been slaves, and that the continent of Africa was accursed by God himself. And this racism is still being battled in the world till today. Also, the transatlantic slave trade cost Africa a lot of progress that would have made as of that era. The people of Africa lost the industrial era, because while the other people of the world were busy inventing industrial machines, Africans were still working in plantations, and Africans were still capturing one another to sell to Europeans as slaves. And Europeans were making sure that this slave trade continued. So the effect of the transatlantic slave trade on Africa was damning. Until today, the effects are still felt. Now, despite the evil effects of the transatlantic slave trade on the continent and people of Africa, despite the losses that we incurred because of this slave trade, there has been no indemnification of the people of Africa for the transatlantic slave trade. Instead, there has been arguments against reparations for the continent and people of Africa for the losses that we suffered because of the slave trade. Now, examples of the arguments against reparations for the transatlantic slave trade is that, number one, Africans were the ones capturing themselves and selling to the Europeans. This argument is a deceptive argument. Why? Like I mentioned earlier, the Portuguese were the ones who began the slave trade and not Africans. Two Portuguese, Nutristo and Anto Gonçalves, were the ones who began the transatlantic slave trade in the year 1441. And 1444, another Portuguese by the name Lancelot de Freitas also mentioned the slave trade began. Therefore, it was Europeans who began the slave trade and recruited the Africans into the slave trade. Also, African leaders, or African kings, queens, and citizens resisted the slave trade, but the Europeans overpowered them. For example, King Afonso of modern day Congo, fought against the slave trade. In fact, he wrote protest letters to King João of Portugal, resisting the slave trade, asking him to stop the depopulation of his kingdom, but courtesy of the Portuguese slave trade that was going on, selling Africans as slaves. He wrote protest letters and all to no avail. Even his successor, King Garcia II, wrote similar unsuccessful protest letters or protested against the slave trade and all to no avail. Queen Zinga Mbandi, queen of a kingdom in present-day Angola, fought tooth and nail to stop the slave trade, and the Portuguese overpowered her. Her successors, all those other ones, tried to stop it, all to no avail. King Akaja of Dahomey fought the Europeans to resist the slave trade. The Europeans resisted and still continued the slave trade, and then his successors couldn't do anything about it. They had to engage in the slave trade. African individuals, people tried their best to resist the slave trade, but when the kings and people of Africa saw that they could do nothing about it, they had no option than to accept the slave trade. So Africans accepted the slave trade under duress and not under that they chose to sell their fellow Africans as slaves. Eventually, the slave trade created a slavery institution in Africa where everyone, in one way or the other, was involved in slavery. That was how Africans began to sell fellow Africans as slaves. Now, let's also talk about another argument that people have raised against reparations. There's an argument that says that the reparations have already been paid in Obama, that the Obama presidency was a reparation. In fact, according to Senator Mitch McConnell, a US senator, there shouldn't be any call for reparation because we have already paid a reparation in the Obama presidency. We signed the landmark civil rights law and we also fought to abolish slavery. Now let's answer the question. The Obama presidency was not a reparation. It was a triumph of popularity. The fight to end slavery, or slavery in America, which was fought by Abraham Lincoln, and many blacks fought also on his side to end it, was an abolitionist movement and not a reparation. Also, the signing of the civil rights law was a law of restitution of human rights, of universal human rights, and not a reparation. If the Obama presidency was a reparation, then what about the 45 white presidents of US? What would you call that? What would you call them? If the civil rights law that allowed Africans to vote and allow Africans more rights to enjoy rights which white people were already enjoying in America, if suddenly that law was a reparation, then what about whites who have been enjoying those rights since time immemorial? What would you call that? The abolitionist movement to end slavery in America was to make everyone on an equal footing, because every human being was born with the right to be free. That was not a reparation. Reparation is to give back what was lost when someone's right was denied, not just to restore the person's right. So for there to be restoration, for that to be called a reparation, there has to be a restitution of losses. Those losses that were incurred during the time of that restriction or that bondage must be paid back to those who were denied those rights. Africans lost money. Africans were not paid for their labor. Africans lost a lot of things because of the slave trade. Paying back those things to Africans is what is called reparations, not just giving Africans back their rights, which are just universal human rights. Also, there's another argument that the present-day Africans, that we're not the ones that were enslaved, and that the present-day Europeans or white people are not the ones who enslaved Africans. Therefore, no call for reparation. Now, to answer the question, the answer goes like this. The present-day Europeans or present-day whites who are in America have control over the American continent, which they inherited from their ancestors. And those ancestors who they inherited the right to control America from are also the ones who carried out the transatlantic slave trade. For them to inherit lordship over the Americas, they also have to inherit the debt that their ancestors incurred by bringing Africans from Africa to work as slaves in the Americas. Also, if there is any debt that Africans are owing the previous generations, Africans of present day generations are obliged to pay those debts, meaning that we inherit debt and we also therefore have to inherit the debt that is owed to us. So that argument cannot stand. There's also the argument that slavery was in existence in Africa before the Europeans came. Yes, slavery existed in all parts of the world, whether in Asia, in Europe, in Israel, in Americas, everywhere, in all parts of the world, in Africa, slavery existed. But Africans killing their economy to sell to the Europeans, that didn't exist before the Europeans came. And that is therefore not an argument, because Africans were selling their brothers to Europeans. That cannot be called trade. As we said earlier, it was done under duress, which created an institution where Africans had to start selling themselves. So that is unacceptable. There's also the statement that Africans benefited from the slave trade. Therefore, Africans shouldn't be talking anything about reparations. Now let's talk about that. What did Africans gain from the slave trade? Like I mentioned earlier, Africans lost over 2 billion persons in population. If you talk about the economic losses, it will be in hundreds of trillions of dollars that Africans lost in the slave trade. How much do Europeans buy Africans? There are talks, there are even instances of Europeans selling a single plate for 10 Africans, selling an umbrella for 20 to 50 Africans, selling a cannon gun for over 100 to 200 Africans. Is that trade? What is the benefit in that? It was the Europeans who benefited from that trade, if you can call it trade, because that should not even be called trade. That is duress. That is subjugation. So Africans did not benefit anything from the slave trade, and the slave trade still contributed or still contributes to the poverty that we are still experiencing in Africa till today. There is no argument enough to stop the call, the just call for reparations. And if we want to even check it, reparations have been paid to other people of the world, and it's only Africans who have been on the side receiving arguments against reparations. For example, in the Holy Bible, according to the Bible, the Israelites were in Egypt for 430 years, and towards the latter end of those 430 years, the kings of Egypt oppressed Israelites and made them to engage in forced labor and unpaid labor. When God sent Moses, according to the Holy Bible, to liberate the Israelites and to bring them out of Egypt, when they are about to leave, God asked the Israelites to demand from the Egyptians whatever they would. And the Egyptians demanded for gold and for many materials, and the Egyptians gave them freely. According to the Bible, the Egyptians gave so much that it affected their economy. That was reparations for the years that the Israelites worked in Egypt free of charge. So that was their reparation. Also, after the First and Second World Wars, reparations were paid. For example, after the First World War, France received over 102 billion marks from Germany for reparations, which in today's money would account for over $270 billion. Also, after the Second World War, the Axis paid reparations to the Allies, just like they did also in the First World War, because France was part of, and Germany was part of the Axis in the First World War and also in the Second World War. Germany paid the reparations to the Allies. They gave up industries, gave up the railways, gave up many vessels as reparations to the Allies. They took, even portions of land were taken over by the USSR in eastern Germany, in eastern part of Germany, and over 12 million Germans were repositioned away from those portions of land, and those lands were occupied by Soviet Union citizens. That was reparation. Also, during the Second World War, Japanese Americans were interned in camps during the war, following the Pearl Harbor incidents. As of today, the US government has paid over $1.2 billion as reparations to Japanese Americans. Also, over $100 billion have been paid as reparations from Germany to Jewish people because of the Holocaust, the Jewish Holocaust that occurred during the time of Hitler. The German people would not say they're not the ones that carried out the atrocities during the time of Hitler, but they have paid over $100 billion as reparations to the Jewish people. Even unjust reparations have been paid. From the year 1825 to the year 1947, Haiti spent close to $21 billion to pay reparations to the France, because France mandated the Haitians to pay reparations to them for colonizing the country. This is unjust reparation, but it has been paid. And because of that, today, Haiti is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. If just reparations have been paid, and even unjust reparations have been paid, then why should reparations for the transatlantic slave trade be an issue? The world should pay reparations to the people of Africa because it is just. To repair the continent of Africa, to end poverty in Africa, to appease the souls of the people of Africa that died during the slave trade and because of the slave trade. To appease even the souls of Africans who have been born but were not born because of the transatlantic slave trade. Justice is to give to everyone what is due to him. And the people of Africa, the wealth that we lost because of the slave trade is due to us, and we're supposed to receive the payment. Also, it's going to repair damages, because the continent of Africa is still suffering the damages of the slave trade, which shows itself in poverty. The poverty in Africa, one of the ways to end this poverty is to repair the damage done during the slave trade, which is what reparation is about. That reparation will go a long way in ending poverty in Africa by helping to build projects across Africa, projects that will help to change the life of people of Africa. Also, reparation will also serve as a way to appease those Africans who died during the slave trade. We have to build monuments to remember them. We have to honor them. We have to hold global memorials in order to honor those Africans who died and to beg for the forgiveness for the evil that we did to them. These are the reasons why we have to pay reparations. And also, even present-day Africans who still feel bad because of the transatlantic slave trade, who in one way or the other engage in crime, or in one way or the other, in order to get back their reparations through fraud or through other ways, or duping people, saying that they are trying to get back their reparations. If reparation for slave trade is paid, then the people of Africa will have no option than to stop all those ways. So these are the reasons why reparations have to be paid. Now, concerning the reparations, there have been attempts by some individuals or some organizations to get back this reparation. For example, a US Congressman, John Conyers, from the year 1989 to the year 2017, kept presenting the bill that the US government should look into this issue of reparation and look into the affairs of the people of African Americans. But the US government could not accept that. In the year 1992, a group of respectable Africans under the auspices of eminent persons came together, including former president-elect of Nigeria, Chief MK Obiola, Kenyan scholar Alima Zuri and Mira Makeba, a singer in South Africa, they all came together with other group of persons demanding for reparations for Africans in any way it could be done. Some have put the reparations bill at $12 trillion. Some said reparations should be at least $777 trillion. For us in OAF, we have looked at it and say, for each century of the transatlantic slave trade, we are demanding $50 trillion as a reparation. Because we're talking about a whole continent that the GDP should be at least $500 billion to $1 trillion every year. And if you put it in modern day money, the GDP of Africa is about $2.9 trillion. Then if you say count losses, so the African continent lost at least $1 trillion in today's money. In today's money, we should measure the GDP that Africa lost during the slave trade, should measure at least $1 trillion per year. And over a period of 100 years, she's talking about over $100 trillion. For 400 years, she's talking about $400 trillion. But at least let's make it a $50 trillion reparation per century. Now, the payment of the reparations must not be done at once. The $200 trillion reparations bill is not much that should be done at once. It could be $1 trillion reparation annually for the next 200 years. And it mustn't be in cash. It could be in technical assistance. Cash should also include building projects in Africa, execution of projects already pending. For example, the Grand Enga Dam in Congo, which would cost over $75 billion and would help to solve the problem of power for over 40% of the African population. That is one of the ways to carry out this reparation. Opening the door for Africans to travel across the world, opening the economy to Africans, increasing the share of Africa in global trade, and assisting Africans in different ways to build the African economy. These are ways reparations should be paid. Building monuments for fallen Africans, remembering them every single year, honoring them, doing things to show that we are displeased with what we did as humanity. These are ways through which the reparations should happen. And we as OAF, we call upon African leaders and African people to come together. Let us get these reparations, because this is our right and this is what must be done. And until reparations are paid, the pressure for reparation will continue until we get it. Also, before I end my talk, I honor Abraham Lincoln, I honor the Quakers, and all the abolitionist groups and persons who fought to end slavery and to end slave trade in America and all over the world. And I believe that present-day whites also would be involved in this present day call for reparations, because we know that whether we are black or white, justice is justice for all. Thank you very much. Eze Chimere Nwauzo is my name. God bless you.